Now I would like to invite Dr. Sushama Joglekar to make her presentation on origami. Dr. Sushama Joglekar presently teaches at Sir J.J. College of Architecture for graduates and postgraduates. Origami is her passion and she has found roots connected with her profession. Dr. Joglekar has organized many collaborations with Japanese consulate along with Origami Mitra organizations. We have also displayed a few of Dr. Joglekar's creation in our exhibition gallery at the AIKTC. Today, Dr. Joglekar will talk about Islamic patterns and forms in Origami.
It is towards architecture origami. I have been origami for many years, and even like origami is considered always as a hobby, you know, children's hobby, not. So in our origami mitra, we always say that it is not children's hobby, it is very much adult thing. And again, for architectural groups, I want to tell you, it is not only for selective as first year thing. And I would away from, you know, small objects, birds and other things. I enjoy doing that. But in the process of your learning, I have myself have, you know, it was a process of maturing for me, because I was consistently, you know, with architecture students and looking at forms and patterns and the way you look at an experiment. And fortunately, you know, in architecture college, you always get a chance to experiment with students. So, you know, ask students to do things and then you can understand things and take it further. And again, you know, you have to do it yourself. So that way the process has started about five, six years back. And then, you know, this is what I'm talking about, architectural origami and two parts. One is patterns and forms, and then it would be architectural forms, and first would be patterns. So first talk would be about patterns. So origami, because we are talking about processes, origami is basically folding. It is just continuous process of folding and maybe sometimes opening it again and folding it back again. So origami is just one process. It is process of folding a paper. And there are one or two basic things. Either you fold front or you go backwards. So there are mountains and valley folds. And most of the origami thing goes about just mountain and valley. And with these two things, you can actually do a lot of things. And which I'll show you in the next few slides. When you have paper in hand, so it happens with technology. And origami doesn't require the golden rectangle, but with a piece of paper and just folding it, you can achieve that. Then origami can be used for creating these forms. You can need not have square paper. You can use A4 paper, you can use circles, anything. And this is possible just by folding without doing any measurements. There are processes also, because you know I showed you it's possible to do 30 degrees angle, 60 degrees angle, and then hexagons and this is equilateral triangle is a perfect rhombus, and hexagon and triangle also is possible. It is just by folding, no measurements, and whatever size of piece of paper you have, you can do it. Now this is by creating patterns. You have shapes which you have created in the paper. You can grade. So for architecture students, take a grade, do these tiles, what I call it as paper tiles, and create patterns. And this can be trial to understand shapes, grids, pattern through that. Now, how to achieve these shapes? Circle. Perfect square is difficult to find, but circle is always there with you. I just cut it from a CD, because CDs are normally we have CDs. So cut a CD and you can actually achieve this angle, because you can always fold a paper into four parts. Just fold it once and fold it again. You know, everybody knows, you know, how to re-roll, you know, fold a chapati. Okay, so you have definitely, you know the center, you have midpoint, then you can do fold one edge to the center, you get one point, then triangle is possible, square is always possible. There are ways of doing pentagon and hexagon also, because it is basically dividing a circle into different parts, and at equality, you are definitely know it's equal, because you have folded and it overlaps perfectly, so it's equal parts. Once you know square, octagon is also possible. You have four parts. Just have one more fold and then use your octagon. Then you move further. You have hexagon, octagon, 10 points is decagon, that is derived from a pentagon, because pentagon can be folded. Then there are stars. Now what is this star and polygon? So next slide I talk about what is a star polygon. Every polygon is a star polygon. I think there are some additional thing that is missing in this stuff seen in this slide. So it is basically, you know, hexagon is a polygon, it's a star polygon, where there are six points which are there on the circle. It is by joining the next point, so it is 6-0 polygon. The next one would be 6-1 polygon, where you are joining the point which is one, not leave one point and then you connect to the next point, then you will get that. So that way, and possibility is like, you know, if you have 6 points, then you can just have one pattern in that. 8 and 10 and 12, it goes on increasing, because there is a possibility of connecting more points to be there. Then it comes to that, you know, because then I thought, you know, I got very confident, like, you know, you can do the grid, you can do the tiles, and then you can fold a pattern. So I started folding a paper, and then, you know, try to get, you know, something, you know, I can just fold the grid, and then I can paint it on that. So suddenly I realized, this kind of patterns, they don't work for normal grid of straight and horizontal 30-60. When I realized that, I started, you know, looking more about these star patterns, and you could see that, you know, this kind of, you know, tile is possible through rectangle paper, A4 by ruling paper. You can do this tile, you can just put one diagonal, other small diagonal, and this is that tile which is there. With that tile, you can get a pointed star. So you can just put it on the octagon and do it. But it doesn't follow straight grid, because with this type of stars, it is always 8-pointed symmetry. So you have to place that in the center and look in all direction of those points, then it will be symmetrical. not just the grid. So you can't have normal grid where you can paint all that. It has to be always one point in the center and then symmetry around that. And that is, you know, that is what Islam, then I thought I can do tiling by, you know, Islamic tiling by origami. So I started working for her. Once I got that tight, then I started looking that again, you know, I worked out, take a square, because you can, with origami, you can easily make the proportion, fold the paper, check it, whether it's proportionate, or take it further. I worked this, and I was very happy, like, you know, I know how to create tights. Started working, you know, it is possible, you can actually, you know, do a tie pattern, using all these are folded, even this octagonal star can be folded by a square paper. Then it came to, like, you know, then I realized, looked at this kind of pattern. I realized these kites are not same. I cannot do one kite and I can use it anywhere else. Because the kites are different because they are connected to a different kind of star. It is not octagonal star in the previous image. Now this has become a decagonal star where it is, every point is connected to the, now leave two points and connect to that and then you get this star. And now with that, I have to work out on other kind of tiles, and which I managed to do that. And I got this kind of pattern. But this is not continuous pattern. And I started reading about, you know, more about Islamic architecture. Pentagon, they have used, but Pentagon cannot make a spread. Pentagon always leaves some space in between. So they have worked out many patterns and everything cannot be explained by origami. So maybe I have stopped that at that and started another process. And maybe, you know, if I continue, maybe sometimes in another 1 or 2 years, I may have something to, you know, to present on Islamic architecture. But, you know, it is just a continuing process when you are looking at the shapes and form and, you know, working with your hands. Then there are ways of, you know, just playing with the polygons. There are just folded, have two color paper, fold it and you get nice star in the between. Then there is a way of, you know, tessellation is one thing which I have not talking because it's a very vast topic. So one example of tessellation, then there is a snowflakes, then there are fractals, and, you know, many things are possible. Just take a paper, fold it and achieve this, you know, these are all patterns and shapes. Then this is called as, you know, these are frobel folds. Just take one paper, same shape, fold it in a similar fashion, just turn the paper around, slightly change the angle, and then you can get this kind of thing. Take a polycarpet or origami twigs. And you can, you know what is called as a godhadi or twig. It is actually connecting things together. So when I say twig, it is not tying. Twig is basically connecting things together, so you have to have some kind of connections in that. So this is how, and you can go on doing these patterns and kind of thing, and just to, you know, understand, you know, that this can be used for understanding the colors, shapes, symmetry, contrast, anything, because, you know, you can have shapes, you can put them and you can understand. Next thing now, you know, connecting it to the architecture. Paper, as whatever I talked about before, I'm talking about horizontality, you know, it's the same plane. Moment you change the plane and, you know, you start lifting the paper, see, tiling or tessellation is where everything is flat, round, you know, then you want all the angles are perfect and, you know, 360, wherever they meet, they are 360 degrees angle. Moment I change something, it will become 3. So that is what the next thing, you know, if you start lifting the paper at some point, you have these creases created, and now some of the creases we have to lift up, and that will create a form and doesn't remain a pattern. So you are changing the angle and taking it to a different plane. So next presentation is, you know, how you can achieve these kind of things, you know, where you just change something, change the angle, and then you can create a form. So now we are talking about, you know, we can have a grid, but now we want to convert that to a form. So I have to change angle of some of the points, and for that I can just have, you know, one folded valley. It can be mountains and it can be mountain and valley. And the grid is possible to have either square grid or it can be angle grid, because I know with origami I can do the angles. Now there are, when I started looking at, you know, how to form a pattern, because, you know, I know I have a grid and I have to have some pattern. So there are four different types of, you know, patterns which are possible. One of them are, you know, simple. First technique is mountain and valley. Mountain and valley is what is origami about. Then there is a reverse folding. Waterfall base, Mura Kori, that is a classical map folding. Like, you just take a map and you, one point you hold and other point you stretch out the entire map. So that is considered as classic map folding. Then there is a Yoshimura pattern and diagonal folding. So everything goes, like, there would be other patterns. As far as I know, these four patterns. Now, you know, even architecture students are, you know, fascinated by these hyperbolic paraboloid roofs. And if you look at the trees pattern, it is just simple mountains and valleys. You just do it. Of course, you require patience of, you know, doing that, those creases and collapsing it. Like, you know, that is the what we use in origami, crease pattern and collapse. So you have to have those, and precision is always required. So it is possible to have circle and circle also. Like, you know, people have not may not have tried hyperbolic parabola with a circle, but it is possible with hexagon, octagon, because wherever you can create mountain and valley, it is possible to have the curvature. And again, you know, I'm reading about it. It says the curvature is not just your folding technique; it is the deformation of the material. So people are researching about deformation, like, you know, how the material behaves. Sometimes it is your folding technique. Sometimes the material also would deform. So hyperbolic parabola with fabric and some other material, the curvature equations might be different. So I talked about these patterns, Mura Kori, it is reverse folding. You could see the folding pattern over there. You have continuous valleys and then mountains, and how they meet at one point. So that gives, you know, that one folding pattern. And it is foldable pattern, because you can just fold, you know, push it on one side, like collapse or collapsible gates, it will collapse. Moment you change the direction, it can become a curve. It was lying flat, but I change the direction of those mountains, reverse the side, and then, you know, it can become a curve. Then another thing, just have these mountains and in between you have valleys, and just make a cylinder out of it, you will get this kind of pattern. So similar, you know, only the angle changed. Now next thing is, what is deployable form? Because, you know, why anybody would have this kind of cylinders and use it? So at times, you know, you have to store away, you know, products, and you take it from some one place to other place, and you have to have deployable structures to do it, stack it, and, you know, take it somewhere else, and, you know, you are using it. So for that, if you have seen the, you know, previous slide, mountains were there, but you had valley lines in between. Here they are crossing that. So because of that, it is possible to compress the thing, and whole thing works as a deployable. It is possible to actually make it flat cylinder.
I don't know whether the video will work.
Then another way of doing is diagonal folding. When you are talking about crease pattern, changing the crease pattern would allow me to have the folding process. Instead of straight folding, it folds like a screw. It's called as a helical process. could see the difference, like, you know, one was helical body, other was straight body. Then I talked about this water bomb pattern. The lines are not very clear over here, but water bomb is something, you know, which is consumed in one part, small part. That is the kind of, you know, achieved by mountain and valley. And when you put it across, so this is part of the tessellation. And if the paper turned to, you know, becomes a kind of, you know, curved thing, and it can be compressed and it can expand also. So it is possible to have these kind of things on really facades. And then another thing, I think most of the students over here have done this magic ball, where you can have the paper. This is a crease pattern for that. All these water bombs are there. In between are the valleys. And you can create these kind of forms, and you can actually play with it. See, this is how it's possible. You can compress, you can change the shape, whatever you have done, the one sheet of paper. And then we have to talk about, you know, how, you know, I can just show you the photographs where, and there are websites also, it's not my work, it's Origami inspired architecture kind of thing, these are the websites. But you know, when I started looking at Origami applications, so I was curious and just went through some websites. There are some examples of buildings where you could see, you know, kind of Origami, either inspired Origami or actual folding things over there. These are the examples of some buildings. Forms, domes. Then this is not Origami, but where you can fold a paper and then look at it and you want to create that form. So this is rigid folding, where you have that shape. Now instead of paper, I will use timber over there. If I want deployable, wherever there is a valley, I will put a hinge over there. So it is possible to have foldable structure with a timber. Using Origami principles of folding. And you can use glass also, because basically, you know, paper model, and then convert that into whatever material you want. Then, you know, nowadays you have these interactive facades with their sensors, and you know, it has to open something for required direction, change direction. So, for that, you have to have a facade with these kind of elements where you can fold and open and change angle. And it is not paper Origami, but behind all that is the using same fold and open principles are would be there. And Origami can be there in product design and interiors also, is a furniture for things. And of course, I mean, it is two people I have to mention, that's Paul Jackson, folding techniques for designers. And it should be there in most, you know, in architects and designers have to look at this book. Just one sheet, and then have small folds, open it, crease it, and then you can have a wonderful pattern with that. And Kuniyoko Kasala, Tomohi Sukariko Tachi, all these people are working at other universities where they had full electives on, you know, working on Origami, and then they have this kind of workshop. Then I realized, you know, what I am doing, it's not, you know, it's not really, then I was happy because I thought, you know, after so many years and then, you know, suddenly I feel like I'm doing Origami. People ask me, do you really enjoy that? So yes, I really enjoy doing Origami. And it's a good thing, and you know, it's a good thing to learn and actually it is relaxing. So that's one more thing I have to tell you. It is relaxing.